X100S. Fujifilm has figured out a way to put an awesome 100 megapixels into kind of like a DSLR sized body, kind of like this Nikon D700. That'll be for another video. Big thanks to Fujifilm North America for sending the GFX100S for us to test drive and play around with. We also got the 80mm 1.7, which is kind of like the full frame equivalent of a 60. It's like an awkward focal length. Now, for video, I thought that the IBIS was really great. Handheld, I got some really cool shots of the animals.
It's a giraffe party house.
And I'm pretty shaky, so I'm holding the camera really tight against my body, you know, you get some motion, but the IBIS is doing a great job. Like, you could really just shoot everything handheld, and so that was impressive. The IBIS in the camera was unbelievable. I did like that there's a dedicated movie switch. There's a little switch which goes from photo to movie. The only issue I had is they didn't continuous autofocus with that switch. So I had to keep going from my single, you know, focus auto. I had to go from my single autofocus for photos. And then if I switch to video, I'm like, why isn't it focusing? You actually have to change the focus mode. So I thought that was a little strange, especially for me. I'm so used to on the X-T20 flipping the auto switch and it just automatically taking care of everything. And so I wish they would have added autofocus to the movie switch. You can, of course, like the X-T4 and X-T3, have the silent movie controls, which means if you flick to movie mode, then it saves your film simulation. It saves your film. Did I just say film simulation twice? Yes, I did. And it's kind of weird shooting with this camera because you know you have like croppability maximus. Like, for example, the flamingos. We were too far away from like getting images of single flamingos with the 80mm lens, but I could take a whole shot of the scene and then later go through my favorite flamingo and compose one shot. And so that I did that a couple of times. I did that with the flamingos. There was also a peacock on a roof. It was like he was so far away, but I could crop in and make a whole new photograph. You know, I think about how like when you're traveling or you're with family, you don't have time to sit and compose on a tripod, or, you know, sometimes there's just a scene and you have to, it's kind of like strange way to photograph, but you know, you can make photos after the fact, which is weird, but you can crop in and make large prints from, you know, just a little corner of your frame. It's kind of crazy to think about, but that is one tool you have at your disposal Disposable? I have command of the English language. Another cool thing is this is the only camera that has the film simulation nostalgic neg. And that's an interesting move by Fujifilm. Like, imagine they start putting, you know, film simulations only in certain cameras. So if you want them, you have to get, that's a pretty sneaky thing to do, but pretty smart. It's a very cool film simulation because it's not too extreme. It doesn't really, it's kind of like the reds are still red, but toned a little down. And it has a really cool look without being too extreme or far away from, you know, the standard film simulation. But since it was a rainy day at the zoo and things were pretty drabby, I went with Velvia. And I think that worked great with shooting the movie and also shooting photographs that match. I think it's a cool thing to do if you travel, is to grab a little bit of, you know, footage in the same film simulation that your photos are going to be. So if you shoot everything in classic chrome, your photos, you know, try to film everything in classic chrome so you have, like, you know, this continuity. Here's another note about taking photographs. I wish that the Fujifilm 100 megapixel camera had it does have a compressed RAW, but, you know, some of the older Canon cameras had a small RAW or a medium RAW that were way smaller in file size, and they didn't have as many megapixels. Here, you're gonna get the full range of megapixels on all your RAW files. They only compress them. And by the way, new Canon cameras are doing this now too. There is no more small RAW. There's just, like, more compressed full RAW. And sometimes we don't want that. So what I actually did was I set my JPEGs to 45 megapixels and they look unbelievable. So you could actually shoot smaller JPEGs, but not RAW. So that was kind of a little like, eh. But with that said, the RAW files compressed were around 60 megabytes, which when you think about it, if you're shooting on an X-T3, X-T4, uncompressed RAWs on those cameras are about 50 megabytes. So we're kind of close to an, you know, a compressed RAW on this is close to an uncompressed RAW on the APS-C system. It could be the camera for you if you want to do mostly photos and a little bit of video. And by the way, I only had one lens, so I didn't really do any technical tests. I don't like doing technical tests. We just had fun at the zoo and it rained and all right, I'll see you guys next time.